exactly how old I was, but I remember being a kid and getting to experience my first snow day. I think I was about, the first one I remember, I think I was about third grade, maybe 10 years old or so. And I remember, like, this is something I'd always looked forward to. A couple of benefits, snow day. You don't have to go to school. And then second, you get to play in the snow. And so as a young man, I'm all about this. I remember waking up one morning and looking out the sliding glass door into our backyard. And there is a blanket of snow. And so my sister and I, we sit down in front of the console television. And we're watching the ticker that rolls across the bottom of the screen, looking, hoping Poto School District's going to tell us that we're out of school. And sure enough, this was the day the stars aligned. God was going to bless us. I was going to get to have a snow day. And so school's canceled. I load up with all the gear. You know, you got all the puffy clothes on. I'm ready to be out in the snow. But I did think twice about my choice of footwear. I'm like, oh, don't get a lot of snow days here. What should I wear in order to navigate this deep snow, at least what it was for Eastern Oklahoma. It wasn't that deep. But regardless, as a 10-year-old kid, I decided that I was going to need a little extra traction that day. And so I went and put on my cleats. A little extra traction, you know, seemed to make sense. And I go out and I am playing. We lived in a neighborhood, lots of houses, lots of kids. And we're having a really, really good time, living it up, height of 10-year-old life, snow day, getting to play, have a good time. But you know, it didn't take very long before that snow, it was actually deeper than the cleats, and so it begins to work its way inside of my shoes, and my feet start to get incredibly cold, and I'm not going to stop, though, because it's a snow day, and I'm having a good time with my friends, but man, then they start to really ache, and all of a sudden, what should have been an incredibly joyful and fun time, and I was miserable. I wasn't enjoying it at all, and so I remember going into one of my buddy's houses. They had a bathtub there, and I thought, I'll just fix this. Turned on that hot water, took my shoes off, and put my feet under the water. But y'all, what should have been really helpful, I mean, something's cold, you warm it up, it was not helpful at all. Instead, it was incredibly painful. And my day that was supposed to be the most joyful day ever, the snow day I'd always looked forward to, it actually turned out to be a very bad day because even as a 10-year-old, y'all, there's things you never want to do. And one of those things is to cry in front of your friends. Did it in front of my friends. That water, it burned so bad. I ended up crying in front of my friends. What should have been a really extraordinary experience actually turned out to be something that was devoid of joy. I didn't get to enjoy that because of something that had happened. And I tell you that story because for many people, that's their experience with Christianity. It's their experience with Christ. What should be a source of incredible joy for us, what should be the abundant life, something happens that robs us of our joy. And rather than living this out and expressing it to the world, man, we live something very different from what we had anticipated. Now, in the Galatian church that we've been looking at, this was their experience. They had started off in the beginning with great joy, but something had happened in their midst that had robbed their joy. And so the Apostle Paul is going to address that for them. He's writing, and in this letter, there's an interesting section. The text we're going to study today, it's called a pastoral interlude. If you were here last week, the Apostle Paul was just really letting the Galatian believers know, you're not a slave anymore. You are a son and or a daughter of God. You need to live like that. And if you're going to come next week, you're going to see that Paul's going to return to that theme. But right here in the middle, it's like he takes a second out, of writing in his normal voice. And he's like, I need to talk to you guys as men and women whom I love. Martin Luther wrote of this passage in particular. He says, these words breathe Paul's own tears. You can see his heart being poured out on behalf of the Galatian church who had lost the joy of their salvation, and they were struggling under the weight of what we'll see in just a moment. So Paul begins in verse 12, and he says, brothers, I entreat you, become as I am, for I also have become as you are. You did me no wrong. You know it was because of a bodily ailment that I preached the gospel to you at first. And though my condition was a trial to you, you did not scorn or despise me, but received me as an angel of God, as Christ Jesus. Now, Paul, this is a little bit unique, Paul's experience with the Galatians, because he was an apostle. He was an apostle to the Gentiles, which meant he traveled around the known world preaching the gospel to people who hadn't heard it. That was his calling. That was his desire. I don't want to build on somebody else's foundation. I want to preach to people who have never heard. But something unique had happened in the life of the Apostle Paul that caused him to stay in Galatia longer than he'd anticipated. He shows up there, he preaches the gospel, people are coming to faith in Christ, but then we see that Paul had some sort of bodily ailment that made him have to hang around. He couldn't travel like he'd anticipated, but he stays there with them. And while he's there, he's teaching and he's preaching. He's discipling the people who are there, kind of helping them grow and mature a bit. Now, we're not told what this bodily ailment was. I mean, and you read various accounts. People that would say everything from malaria to some sort of disease with his eyes, we'll get there in just a minute. But there was something going on with the Apostle Paul that was not good. No one would have invited this into their life, and yet it turned out for the good of the Galatians because Paul got to be with them. He spent time among them. They actually had to take care of him. He describes his ailment, whatever this was, as a trial for these brand new believers that had heard him. They'd embraced the gospel, but all of a sudden they're having to care for the messenger of the gospel. Now, here's what I want you to see. There is a grace effect in our lives. When we receive the gospel, it does something to us. Grace has its effect in our lives, and it changes us. It transforms us, and it happened very quickly among the believers in Galatia. And so we see this first in the way that they received the Apostle Paul. He comes and he preaches, and they come to faith in Christ, and these new believers are transformed by the gospel. And he points out specifically the first way we see this grace in their lives was through the way that they received him. He says, though I had this condition, though it was a trial to you, you did not scorn or despise me, but you received me as an angel. That means a messenger of God or as Christ Jesus. He's like, man, you cared for me like I was sent to you directly from God. You cared for me as you would have Christ Jesus. Like you received me. Now, this trial, this illness, apparently, it wasn't like a moderate sort of thing. It would have probably evoked some level of disgust among the people. He anticipates maybe the appropriate response for the people or the one he would have expected is that they would scorn or despise him because of this illness, but they didn't. Now, I don't know about you. I'm not a germaphobe. I'm not one of those people. But when flu season comes around, it inevitably happens, by the way, and we want you to come to church. I'm not telling you not to. But when flu season comes around, people are, they're going to show up at church, and it's like their badge of honor. They're like, yeah, I've been out of work for 3 days. I've been hacking and coughing, running the fever. Man, I'm miserable. But here I am. They want to shake my hand, and I'm like, hey, maybe you should go home. You know what I mean? Like, I don't want what they had. And I don't, again, we don't know Paul's specific illness, but I'm sure these believers did not want what the Apostle Paul had. And yet there was something in their hearts that said, you know what? We need to embrace this man. We need to care for him. Paul says, you went so far as to care for me as you would have Christ Jesus himself. But it's not all that unusual that believers would do that, right? Because grace has an effect on our lives. So here's the gospel. The gospel is we had something wrong with us, right? We had this condition in our lives called sin, which separated us from God. God is perfectly holy, and we were utterly sinful. And what we deserve from God is to be rejected, to be despised, to ultimately endure punishment. But here's what God did for us. He chose to extend to us his grace. Now, grace is unmerited favor. We couldn't earn it, and we don't deserve it, but God freely gave it. Now, just to be really clear, God was not unaware of your sin. As a matter of fact, he looks down through all of eternity. He knew your sins of the past, the sins you're going to commit today, the ones that you'll commit in the future. He wasn't unaware of your sin, but he was undeterred by your sin. The love of God drove him, knowing our sinful condition, to offer his son, Jesus Christ, on the cross. Like, even though we were sinful before God, he pursued us. He sent his son Jesus to suffer and bleed and die on the cross that we might have life. The Apostle Paul's like, man, look how the gospel was at work in you, the Galatian believers. Because God had saved you, even though you had this condition, man, you in turn demonstrated the gospel back to me. You received me as a messenger of God, as you would have Christ Jesus himself. Something had happened in the hearts of these Galatian believers. Paul was an outsider. He had issues, whatever those were, but they received him. And this word in the Greek, it means to invite someone in. It means to bring them into your home or invite them into your family. And they had done that with Paul. They had shared life together with him. This was the response when you received the gospel, right? But there was a second way that they had served Paul and demonstrated the gospel for him. And we see this in verse 15. He says, "For I testify to you that if possible, you would have gouged out your eyes and given them to me." Now, there's a little bit of speculation regarding this phrase. Is it hyperbole? Because, I mean, who's going to gouge out their eyes and whatever? There's some speculation that says that the condition the Apostle Paul had was with his eyes. And so they would have gouged out their eyes and given them to him because that's how much they loved him. Regardless of what he means here exactly, if that was his illness or not, there's hyperbole in play here that says what Paul's pointing out is the extent that they were willing to go to sacrifice on Paul's behalf. Because they loved him, they were willing to sacrifice for him. And once again, this is just the effect that the gospel has on our lives, right? Jesus spared not his own life in order to save us, in order that we might have life. He was sacrificially seeking our good, willingly going to the cross for us. And these Galatian believers, they receive the gospel, and all of a sudden they're turning around and serving one another sacrificially, just as Jesus Christ had served them. Y'all, this is the anticipated effect of the gospel on our lives. These brand new believers who probably didn't know all the scripture, didn't have Sunday school when they were kids, they've just come to faith in Christ. They are living out the gospel. Paul's like, I've seen that. Man, I've experienced that in your lives. Like, it's this beautiful thing that was happening. You were so full of joy and love. You just brought me in as one of your own. You served me and cared for me sacrificially in the midst of this thing that was a trial to you. You still cared for me. Man, they were killing it. As a church goes, like, if that's how we live, man, that's living out the gospel, right? But then something happened in the church of Galatia that stole that joy. Something happened that threw them into confusion and division, so much so that they were now questioning their relationship with Paul. They were fighting amongst themselves. They were disillusioned. They were discouraged, such that Paul even asked the question in verse 16. He says, "Have I then become your enemy by telling you the truth?" Now, what had happened in the church at Galatia was when the Apostle Paul finally heals up, life's good, he's not grossing people out wherever he's going, right? He moves on and he continues to preach the gospel. That's what God had called him to do. But when Paul left the church at Galatia, some false teachers had come in. And these false teachers said, you know what? It's not unmerited favor. It's not just grace. We're saved by grace through faith in Jesus. No. We're saved by grace through faith in Jesus plus by the works of the law. You need to add some law in here too. You need to keep the commandments, like kind of earn your way before God. Make sure that you're doing enough of the right things to be pleasing, and then you're going to get God's favor. Now, Paul has already told us, like, that is slavery. If you haven't been with us over the last several weeks, you need to know this. The law of the Old Testament, you start reading in Genesis, you're going to run into it pretty quickly. Genesis, Exodus, Leviticus, Numbers, Deuteronomy, you're going to get the law there. The law had a very specific purpose, and that was to make us aware that we need a Savior, right? The law reveals that we are sinful. If you've attempted to live a pretty good life. When I was a kid, I used to have these days where I thought I was kind of becoming a pretty good kid. There would be one of those rare days where I wouldn't get a whipping from my parents. And I'd think, man, I'm like really mature and I'm growing up. I'm doing pretty well. And without fail, that afternoon, I was getting it. I was going to mess up. If you've ever tried to live, even the Ten Commandments, you know that you can't do it. What the law does is it makes us conscious of just how sinful we are. And if you just live a life under the law, that gets to be heavy. your sins, they stack up and they begin to weigh you down. You begin to feel the guilt and the shame of what you've done, who you've been, the mistakes that you've made, the ways that you blew it, the people that you hurt. And that gets to be a crushing weight on your shoulders. And these teachers have come back into the church for people who had joy because they'd been set free from their sins. Jesus had taken their sins and credited to them his righteousness. They were free. They'd come back in and they'd place the burden of the law on their shoulders again. And they were now bitter. And they were disillusioned. They were being crushed by the weight of the law. They were beginning to fight amongst themselves about what was true and about what was false. And all of a sudden, what was this source of great joy in their life, the hope of the gospel, was now being distorted and causing confusion. The people were disillusioned. Last week, Paul told us that the ways that they responded to this, some of them got so frustrated with all the fighting and all the stuff, they just went back to their old way of life. They began worshiping those false gods again. They went back to their lives of sinful indulgence and revelry. They were discouraged and disillusioned, so they returned back to their sin. Other people in the church, when this new teaching had come in, they went back to the slavery of the law. Now, any departure from the true gospel leads to slavery. It might look like sinful indulgence, and it might look like self-righteousness, but both are slavery, right? Now, here's what Jesus did for us. He came to earth and lived a perfect, sinless life. He fulfilled the law at every single point. Whereas we couldn't uphold the law, Jesus did it perfectly. And then he went to the cross willingly, lovingly, joyfully for us. And there on the cross, for those of us who place our faith and trust in Jesus and not in ourselves, God takes all of our sin, guilt, and shame, sins of the past, the present, and the future. He places them on Jesus there on the cross, and Jesus bears the just penalty for our sin. You see, God isn't just love. He is love. We celebrate that, but he is also perfectly just. And as such, he couldn't leave our sins unpunished. But Jesus, he bore our sin and our guilt and our shame on the cross. He endured the punishment that our sins deserved. But God did more than that on that day, right? He took our sins and he placed them on Jesus, and Jesus offered himself as an atoning sacrifice for sin. But he also took that perfect, righteous life of Jesus, and he credited that to our account, so that we're not saved by observing the law or trying to earn favor with God. We are saved by faith in Jesus Christ alone. That is grace. It is God's unmerited favor that is just poured out on us, and it is wholly undeserved. For these Galatians believers, they turn back to the law and they turn back to their sin. You see, the enemy had come into the church and he brought destruction. He'd stolen their joy. He'd sowed seeds of division and confusion. And as a result, the people were not living out the abundant life that God had for them. He says about these teachers, he says, they make much of you. This means they are zealous for you. They want to win you over. He says, they make much of you, but for no good purpose. Man, it's not for good. The gospel, Paul's like, I'm zealous for you, right? I wanted to win you over for the truth of the gospel, that you might experience abundant life. These teachers have another agenda, and it's not a good one. They want to shut you out. They want to divide you. They don't want you to experience the fullness of life in Christ. They want to shut you out from that. They want you to go from slavery or from sonship back to a place of slavery. Now, he talks about himself. He says, it's always good to be made much of for a good purpose. And he's like, it's totally fine if you're zealous for people. Man, if you want their good, if you want to bring the gospel and the freedom that we have in Christ, man, that's awesome. Like, that's a good purpose. But then he goes on and he talks about his heart for them. He says, my little children. And this is a term of endearment. He's like, I saw you come to faith in Christ in your infancy as you were believing the gospel. He says, for whom I am again in the anguish of childbirth until Christ is formed within you. This trial had been painful not just for the Galatians, but also for the Apostle Paul. He was in anguish for them. He wanted to see Christ be formed in them and for that to bear fruit in their lives. But at this moment, in their confusion, in the midst of this false teaching, they were divided. They were disillusioned. They were hurting. They were returning to their sin and returning to the law. And he's like, I guess I'm in the anguish of childbirth again. Now, they weren't obviously being born again, right? They were just having to be going back to the beginning of the gospel, the initial things that Paul had told them. He even says this in verse 20. He said, I wish that I could be present with you. And I wish we could see each other face to face and you could hear my tone and my love and affection for you. I would love to change this tone. I'm not having to rebuke you, but we could celebrate again, for I am perplexed about you. They had joy. They had the hope of the gospel. But something had come in and stolen their joy. Now, Paul points them back to the truth of the gospel. He points them back to the work of Christ on their behalf. In a few weeks, we're going to get to freedom, y'all. I can't wait to get there. It's beautiful. But Paul is just reminding them of the hope of the gospel that they had in Christ Jesus. Now, this might feel a little distant, because maybe you've never had a Judaizer come into the church and try to teach you to obey the Old Testament law. But you know, the enemy pursues our church just like he did the church at Galatia. You know, he wants to take your joy and your faith, where you see the gospel, how God has loved you, and it just motivates you to love and serve and care for other people just as God has done for you. He wants to steal that joy, wants to steal that passion, he wants to steal that love, and he wants to make your life unfruitful. You know, one of the ways that this happens in the Church of Jesus Christ today that I've seen over the years is oftentimes the enemy will work through someone in the church that hurts you. And maybe that's your story here today. And you were in the church, you think back to a time in your life where you were loving and serving Jesus. Man, your heart was just filled with passion and joy. And you're like, man, where can I serve? Where can I jump in? It might have even been you remember back to the time where you came to faith in Christ and you couldn't stop telling people about Jesus. You're bringing them to church, you're discipling, you're praying, you're all about the work of the Lord. But then somewhere along the way in the church, you got hurt by somebody. Now, it wasn't Jesus that hurt you, but it was someone who bore the name of Jesus, or at least they said they did. Maybe it was a teacher or a leader or a man or a woman that you respected. And somewhere along the way, they hurt you. Maybe they treated you like you weren't valuable or like you were unimportant. Maybe they used you in some way. And for whatever reason, that hurt has taken root in your life and has begun to steal your joy. And rather than living out the gospel outwardly to other people, fulfilling the purpose that Christ has for you, and you find yourself confused and hurting and disillusioned. And if you were just honest with your life, it's become a little bit unfruitful. The question that Paul asked them in verse 15 is, what has become of your blessedness? He's like, man, I remember the relationship that we had. I remember the life that you were living, how you were loving and serving the God. Man, you did it for me. You brought me in. What's become of your blessedness? Man, you've received God's grace and you were pouring it out to other people. What happened? You know how we deal with hurts in the church or even outside, with disillusionment and confusion? And we go back to the beginning. We go back to the gospel and we remember why we were loving and serving and caring for people in the first place. It wasn't for them. It was in obedience. It was out of worship to Jesus. It was out of gratitude for what they had done, what he had done for us. And we weren't serving people. We were serving the Lord. We were offering ourselves in service to him. So maybe for you today, what you need to do is to bring your hurt and your pain, your disillusionment, your confusion. Bring that to the foot of the cross. Maybe you just need to be reminded of the gospel, that Jesus Christ saw you and he loved you. And he knew your whole life, your sin, your guilt, your all that stuff. He saw it and he still chose you. And he chose to save you and adopt you and make you his own. Though you had sinned against him in extraordinary ways, he went to great lengths to forgive your sin and to make you his own. And to live life with you, sending his spirit to dwell within you, that you might have fullness of joy. If you're here today, maybe your response to the message is just to bow your head before the Lord and acknowledge, God, I've been hurt, and I need you to heal me. God, I'm confused about what's happening. And I remember a day I was totally in, and then somewhere along the way, man, things got dark. Jesus, would you renew and would you restore my soul? Would you help me to see the beauty of the gospel? Once again, God, I want you to be formed in me, right? I want to see this growing. I want to be mature in you. I want to be fruitful once again. Now, maybe that's not your story. Now, maybe you haven't been hurt in the church, but somewhere along the way, your faith has grown cold. Maybe you got distracted pursuing the things of this world. And if you were just to tell the story of your life, you might counsel people and be like, listen, these things are not that important in my life. Like maybe it's like it's ball, or maybe it's your job, or maybe it's some worldly achievement. Maybe it's something that you're pursuing, and you're like, listen, that's not what's most important. But your life might tell a different story, that you have grown callous to the things of God because you're so busy pursuing the things of the world. And for whatever reason, you don't have the joy that you once had. Again, the question that Paul would ask of us, what has become of your blessedness? Now, what are you doing with the grace of God that you have received? Jesus Christ died for you. He offered himself as an atoning sacrifice for your sins. And the only appropriate response, according to the scriptures, is that we would offer ourselves as a living sacrifice in return to God. That's what gratitude looks like. Maybe today you need to be reminded of the gospel and the hope of eternity that motivates us to live lives of worship before God. Now, if you're here and you don't know Jesus Christ, you've never come to faith in him, maybe you know the story of the Bible, maybe you understand what sin is and salvation, but the light's never fully gone off in your mind where you believe the gospel and you trust in Christ. If that's you today, I want you to know, I would love to sit and visit with you about what it means to follow Jesus. Like, we're going to have a time of response in a few minutes. And meet me down here. I would love to pray with you. If you want to grab someone in your row and be like, hey, explain the gospel to me, they would love to do that. But before we get to that point, can I just do a little poll for you? Can I take a pastoral interlude from this message and just make you aware of some ways that I believe that God wants us as a church to live out the gospel in our community? The first way is this. I was made aware a couple of weeks ago, within our own community, there are a number of needs. There are several young people, kids on up, who are in need of foster care. Now, the reason that we would show hospitality and receive people is because that's what God has done for us, right? We would adopt kids into our home, open our homes and our lives up. It's because that's what Jesus has done for us. And maybe as you sit there today and you think about the gospel and what God has done, God is stirring in your heart to open your home and your life to a young person that needs foster care or adoption. And if that's you, let me just encourage you to respond in obedience to Jesus. What we would love to do as a church is to come around you and support you and encourage you in that journey. If that's not you, you're like, no, that's not where we are in our life stage. I'm not that thing. There's another way you can still support that ministry in our church. One of the things that we have here, it's called our giving ministry. In 2003, it's our last full calendar year that I can report, we spent in excess of $50,000 as a church supporting primarily families, foster care, kids who are in need of adoption. We're buying clothes for kids that just got removed from mom and dad, and their world is upside down and they don't have anything. Our church is able to step in. We can buy them a bed to sleep in, get them supplies that they need for school. We can support families who are fostering and adopting. And so if you can't do that in your own home, another way that you can do that is by giving above and beyond your normal giving to our giving funds. And here's what I want that to look like. I'm asking every family in our church to consider giving $10 per month. That's a couple of frappes at McDonald's, right? It's not a huge sacrifice, but it's something that we can all participate in together in order to exhibit and display the gospel to our community. So if you're willing to do that, if God would lead your heart to do that, you can go online, you can set this up to be automatic. You'll never think about it. Most of you will never miss the $10, but God will take that, and he's using it to bless these kids who are in a very difficult place in their lives, and they know the Church of Jesus Christ loved me enough to provide for me and to help me in this time, okay? So those are two ways, foster and adopt. And by the way, if you do feel called to that, And we have people that would love, who've been through that before, they would love to walk with you through the process. So if you feel called to it, please get in touch with me and someone here on staff. We would love to connect you with them, and we'll walk with you through that journey. The other way is through that simple giving of $10 a month. And then there's one final way I want to encourage you guys to live out the gospel, and that is through giving toward Antonio and Daniela Correa. They are our church planters who are in Madrid. If you're not familiar, 18 months ago, we sent a Venezuelan couple to Madrid, Spain, to plant a church there. And since then, last 18 months, man, there are 80 to 100 people who are now gathering as a new church in that city. They've baptized in excess. I think over 10 people have already come to faith in Christ already. Man, God is doing a great work in a city of 7 million people where only 2% or less know Jesus. Man, there's a new church there. The light of the gospel is beginning to shine. But I'm going to be honest with you. In a European city, cost of living is pretty high. Man, they've been living for 18 months off of about the equivalent of $42,000 a year. And like you're probably feeling at home, man, things are tight. And our church is supporting them as much as we possibly can from our general fund. But what I'm going to ask some of you to do, we need 10 to 15 couples or families to say, I'm going to commit to giving $100 a month to the sending fund. You can put it in the line on your check if you do that, if you want to just indicate that as you give online. Like, this is for Antonio and Daniela. They need more help, and we need people who will partner with us and give sacrificially as God has given to us. So if God's laying that on your heart today, and you can visit with me about that, you can go ahead and do that online. You can write a check, but that commitment would be that for the next year, $100 extra a month. That's, you're going to feel that, right? That's going to cost your family something. And yet we're reminded that Jesus has first sacrificed for us. He's given to us, and that's why we ultimately give to others. Would you bow with me? Father, we're thankful that we get to be a part of the work that you're doing, of seeing men and women come to faith in a city that most of us have never been to, God, and you're doing a work there. The light of the gospel is beginning to shine, and we pray that you would continue to save more and more. And Lord, as we focus in a city overseas, help us to not lose sight of the community around us. Lord, may we live out the gospel, being the church of Jesus Christ to the people that you bring across our path every single day. And so, Lord, for those who are giving, I pray that you would just give them the confidence and the faith to trust in you to provide where they might, be giving things and be afraid that you're, you know, that maybe they won't have enough. Father, may you provide richly for them. And God, may you continue to allow us to invest heavily back into our community. We pray this in the name of Jesus. Amen. Right now, we're going to have a time of response, and I'm just going to invite you to say yes to Jesus. If you don't know Jesus Christ, and he's drawing you to faith today, would you say yes to Jesus? Man, if you've been hurt, and Jesus is inviting you to lay those burdens down and to trust him to heal your heart, would you say yes to Jesus? If you've become distracted and caught up in the things of this world, maybe you're disillusioned and you've gone back to your life of sin and Jesus is calling you back to the gospel, say yes to Jesus. If you've found yourself falling back into legalism, wanting to earn your way to favor, and he's just inviting you to receive his grace by faith alone, bringing nothing else but your sin and your faith to the table, say, Jesus, I just want to trust you to save me. Would you say yes to Jesus? I invite you to stand and respond in obedience to him.